Chapter 4, Land Use.
In the last two chapters, we've heard how wetlands and watercourses provide many benefits, such as flood control and biological productivity. But the functions and values of these resources can only be maintained if the surrounding watershed's natural processes are not disrupted.
Watershed management is essential to protecting our precious wetland and watercourse resources.
A properly functioning watershed controls runoff, holds sediment, and treats pollution before it gets to a wetland or watercourse. And it will protect essential habitat for a diversity of organisms.
That makes good sense, environmentally, financially, and socially.
The watershed's natural processes are affected by man-made alterations to the landscape. Too many times these impacts are disruptive and cause a variety of problems.
Let's hear from the experts.
So an important role for inland wetland commissions is to try to regulate and control the development that occurs in close proximity to water bodies and wetlands. A harder thing to control is the development throughout the watershed.
If we want to ensure that we have healthy populations of amphibians and many species of wildlife that rely on wetlands, we really need to start looking at wetlands not as separate entities or an individual habitat, but as part of a larger ecosystem that includes the forest and the surrounding landscape.
The decisions that are made by an individual wetland commission, the impacts go well beyond the town boundaries. So we need to be careful about using nutrients and pesticides and chemicals. We need to reduce impervious surfaces.
So we have the University of Hartford campus with this extensive parking lot. This area is very low. It's definitely in the floodplain. More than likely, this used to be a wetland. And typically, during a high flow event, this will overflow. And there are documented cases where students' cars get flooded out. Then they direct all their storm water down into these storm drains, which is the engineered conveyance system. That conveyance system then moves down very quickly, and it essentially short circuits the buffering capacity that you find around many of your waterways. Now, if we look across the river, what we end up seeing is what it probably used to look like, where you had the floodplain, which has little channels, has little pockets and depression areas which fill with water, which enhance water storage, which provide habitat, and which also provide chemical treatment. And so you're looking at the two contrasting impacts. One is more of a natural system, what we want a wetland to be, and the other is the negative impacts from development and from creating impervious cover.
But when we develop right up to the edge of wetlands and we don't leave upland buffers, urban runoff comes into wetlands and it creates huge problems, not only with killing plants directly due to contaminants and poisons such as gasoline, but it also brings in more invasives and just really removes some of the functionality of those wetlands.
If you look at a upper level stream, such as the Mount Hope, the nutrient source is through leaf fall and woody debris. If you clear cut to the edge, not only are you going to change the runoff and the amount of sediment that goes into it, but you'll change the entire ecology of the stream. Now, you need to have that forested buffer, that forested cover, in order for a stream to function in a healthy ecological way.
Riparian buffers in terms of measuring biological health of the stream are extremely important. And one of the things that we consistently find where we sort of rub up against the threshold where we don't really see good critters anymore, it's right around 10 or 11% imperviousness. And in every case where we have good critters, the riparian corridor is intact.
Whenever our infrastructure crosses a river or stream, especially when we think about railroads and roads, we have the potential to disrupt those systems. When you look at a river and stream system, you can see that movement potential is very limited going up and down in the water column, and it's very limited moving bank to bank. There's not much room there. The important dimension for movement is upstream and downstream. And so that's where the vulnerability to fragmentation comes in, is these long linear systems need to maintain free movement upstream and downstream in order to maintain healthy populations.
Impacts from development need to be carefully thought out and evaluated to protect the functions and values of wetlands and watercourses.
But not all human engineering has negative consequences.
Good point. A well-crafted plan of development can try to fix problems that have occurred because of changes in the landscape. For example, implementing best management practices will help to maintain and improve the functions and values of wetlands and watercourses.
Let's take a look at some examples.
We're on an active logging operation in Willington, Connecticut. It's about 40 acres. And this is a thinning operation, which you're just taking some of the trees that are unhealthy, and they're cutting those trees out and leaving the healthier, straighter ones for the future. Foresters have been trained to understand wetlands and watercourses, their values and functions. And also, they've been extensively trained in best management practices to protect those values and functions. This is a great example of a best management practice. It's a homemade bridge. This is four steel girders and some timbers. And that's on each section, and for the middle, they've filled it with small poles. The purpose of these logs being in the middle is to keep the logs from dragging through the stream bed.
The wetland behind me here is an example of a degraded wetland system. It doesn't have much in the way of functional significance any longer. It's isolated within the landscape. The vegetation has long ago been stripped from it, and it's been maintained for a number of years as lawn. Through the development application that came to the Wetlands Commission, there was an opportunity to increase the functional significance of the wetland while also partnering to meet some of the needs of the development. So in this case, stormwater is going to be diverted to the wetland. The wetland has a condition that it cannot be mowed but once or twice a year, so it has to be maintained as a meadow. So we're increasing the functional significance of the wetland by giving it a more robust vegetative community, which in turn does a better job at renovating stormwater. So this wetland in its degraded condition was not an excuse to do away with it. In fact, it turned into an opportunity to balance the overall development scheme of the property.
So a lot of the problems with water bodies and wetlands in developed areas stem from the amount and rate that stormwater gets transferred through the engineered system to the receiving water bodies. And if you can try and mitigate this through processes that mimic the natural system, this is what we call low impact development. One example for this in Connecticut is the Green Capital Project, where they just implemented a series of low impact development technologies at the Capitol as a demonstration of what this technology can do.
This little infiltration island is really managing all of the runoff that comes off of this parking lot. Runoff comes into this area and that gets retained in this basin that has a special soil mix and has vegetation that are great at uptaking the amount of water that they'll receive and are good in wet conditions. It'll get held here and infiltrated in this island. So here you have an example of standard concrete walkway where water hits it when it rains and all of it will get washed away down the slope into the roadway and the storm drain system. On this other side, you have pervious concrete, which is a much better way to manage stormwater because it allows for the water to seep through it and to store it in a pretty significant layer of subbase, so it'll eventually allow for all of that water to be infiltrated into the ground, and it will result in less water getting into the storm drain system, causing impacts downstream and washing away any pollutants that you find on hard surfaces.
So we like to maintain large interconnected stretches of rivers and streams to maintain a large interconnected population of as many organisms as possible. This provides resilience in the face of disturbance. So there's got to be a way for things to move back upstream. And that's where we run into problems with things like culverts that are poorly designed and dams that block upstream passage.
When you put in a dam, you're breaking the connection between the freshwater and the saltwater environment. Now, fish and species can't move from fresh to salt. What we do when we put in fishways, and this isn't just this fishway, but all around the state, is we are reconnecting the freshwater and saltwater environments. The fishway is over 700 feet long. It passes fish up and over a 59-foot high dam. basically 1 foot at a time. There are 59 pools and 59 slots to pass fish up and over a 59-foot high dam. We count all the fish that both come up and down the fishway. We also have a separate downstream bypass to take fish down around from the turbines in the hydroelectric plant and return them to the river downstream of the dam.
We're actually sort of in the midst of a pretty significant transition in the way we think about crossing rivers and streams when we build roads. We're no longer thinking solely about moving water from one side of the road to the other. And we're thinking more and more about how to maintain the continuity of the river and stream environment so that we can maintain passage for the full range of organisms and also the ecological processes that sustain these systems. The ultimate goal is to try to create a structure that's invisible to the animals that have to pass through it. And so the larger the structures that we create, the more likely we can accommodate various different species of wildlife. And the biggest structures themselves can accommodate things like moose, which you'd rather have going under the road than over the road anyway.
By utilizing best management practices such as low impact development or ecologically friendly stream crossings, we can enhance and protect our important wetland and watercourse resources. We've only covered the basics of the functions and values that wetlands and watercourses provide.
These resources offer many other benefits, including recreational opportunities and aesthetic appreciation.
That's right. Remember, the Connecticut Inland Wetlands and Watercourses Act recognizes that these resources are an interrelated web of nature, essential to hydrological stability and the existence of many forms of animal, aquatic, and plant life.
And yet many inland wetlands and watercourses have been destroyed.
The preservation and protection of wetlands and watercourses and their functions and values are essential to the health and welfare and safety of our society.
One last thought.
A lot of times we think of land in terms of small little patches that people own. And they own it for a period of time and then they turn it over to a new owner. But actually the land has been here for a very, very long time. And the land will be here for many, many thousands of years after we're gone. What gets done to that land during that brief time of ownership can have significant impacts on what that land will provide or what that land will be like thousands of years into the future. We have been the beneficiaries of all the ecosystem services that are provided by healthy forests, by healthy rivers and streams and wetland systems. And we need to be aware of that because we can jeopardize that with the actions that we take today. We need to balance our need for economic growth, for places to live, for food, for fiber, against the need of the ecological infrastructure to stay healthy so that the things that we rely on there aren't jeopardized, not just in our own lifetimes, but for the many generations to follow.